We have to be stewards of our environment. We have to be able to protect the rich biodiversity that's on our planet because we benefit from that. Scientific research is critical because that gives us the information we need to really understand what it is we need to put our resources into protecting. My name's Tracie Simon. I'm the director of the Wildlife Conservation Society's molecular lab based at the Bronx Zoo. We do a lot of diagnostic testing to screen animals that are in our collection. We do PCR to monitor for a lot of different pathogens. We also help develop portable technologies that we can take into the field and really empower our researchers around the world to be able to do diagnostic testing on the spot. My career trajectory has taken a very circuitous path because I was really interested in studying disease and mechanisms of disease. And particularly at the time, I really thought I was going to go into cancer research. On the side, started studying amphibians. And this was because I had met Anton Simon. He's a climate scientist who's now my husband. And he was leading expeditions down to Peru to understand how climate change is impacting high mountain environments. And so on one of their expeditions, they were speaking to the local communities, the Quechua communities, who informed them that they'd been seeing a lot of frog die-offs. Anton knew I worked in an experimental pathology program and reached out to me, and so that's how I came aboard the project. I love high mountain environments. This is an area that I've invested research in over two decades now. We've been doing continuous monitoring of amphibians up in the upper reaches of the Andean ecosystem.
This is probably the highest herpetological site up here. It's at 17,000 feet. What we're collecting is Pleuridema marmoratum.
Amphibians, they're basically indicator species that tell us a lot about how the environment is changing.
What we're doing is swabbing these frogs to test for amphibian chytrid fungus. We first found amphibian chytrid fungus here in 2003.
So as the glaciers are receding, you're getting new ponds that are forming higher and higher up. When these new ponds form, that creates the environment to where pollens get deposited up there and microbes, and that starts building the soils, and then those soils can start allowing the growth of plants, which then bring up insects, and so the whole biosphere is actually rising in response to the rising global temperatures. We also have research part of the lab where we take on projects with collaborators. Some of that diagnostic support has been through developing eDNA tests. eDNA stands for environmental DNA, and it is DNA that's shed from organisms that exist in an environment. It's DNA that can be captured through, for example, water samples, soil samples, and even air samples. And it's a powerful tool that allows conservationists to search for rare and threatened species, look for evidence of specific species. You can use it to perform biodiversity assessments to look at all the organisms in the environment. Our first area where we've opened the door to eDNA analysis for biodiversity assessment was actually done on Mount Everest in 2019. So the expedition actually was very interdisciplinary. Pulled scientists from all over the world, and so they needed some biologists. So our idea was to do basically collect water samples along an elevational gradient up to the highest ponds. When we were camping on the glacier at Everest Base Camp, we were sleeping on a moving glacier. And the sound of the crackling of the glacier beneath your tent as you're falling asleep, and the thunderous roars of the avalanches coming down. It's both scary, but at the same time, it's just amazing to hear it. From these 10 sites that we identified, we collected over 20 liters of water. When we brought that back to the lab, we performed analysis of the eDNA that we captured from the filters from those 20 liters of water. And we performed whole genome shotgun sequencing, so we sequenced everything. But we also performed DNA metabarcoding, where we targeted what you call a DNA barcoding gene, which is a mitochondrial DNA target, to then identify organisms often down to the species level. Out of this analysis, we identified 187 taxonomic orders from 36 phylum, which is quite impressive. It's across the entire tree of life. So we identified everything from a few viruses, bacteria, fungi, plants, animals. When you put into context the number of taxonomic orders that we recovered from these 20 liters of water, when we compare them to total known taxonomic orders of around the world, we discovered basically 1/6 of global taxonomic orders just on this one mountain above 4,500 meters, which is quite remarkable, especially when you think about areas around the Earth above 4,500 meters occupies only about 3% of land mass. It was quite striking that we found that level of diversity up on the high slopes of Everest. I mean, we are really pushing the boundaries with trying to detect eDNA. One of our projects where we're focused on trying to detect this very rare turtle species in Vietnam called Raphida swinoi, which is the Yangtze Giant Softshell Turtle. Our researchers can go out and systematically test lakes and rivers for the presence of this species. And it's really critical that we find additional individuals in order to save the species from going extinct, because they're really on the verge of blinking out. As stewards of the Earth, we need to be able to ensure that generations to come benefit from the rich biodiversity on our planet.